lined up, Mr. Luis Berga. So to get a little bit of an overview about Luis's career up till now, his background is in finance and entrepreneurship. He started his career working in investment banking, doing small M&A deals and business valuations. From there, he left investment banking to join Techstars, which is a global technology accelerator where he would help Austin programs achieve business milestones and prepare for fundraising. After Techstars, he moved into venture capital, where he led due diligence, portfolio support at two early stage firms. Luis is actually also a startup founder himself. He is a COO and co-founder of Music Meets Video. He's worked in everything from product development, fundraising, partnerships, marketing, and sales. And now he's currently working on a stealth mode startup focused on solving chronic joint pain using fitness technology. So what's great about Luis is he has a real 360 view of the process of, you know, not only starting your own company, but what it looks like from an outside investor perspective. So thank you again for participating in this and getting on the show.
Yeah, of course. Happy to be here.
So kind of the first question that I want to ask is why you decided to pursue a career in finance and kind of what that career journey looked like for you. And then subsequently, what made you decide that entrepreneurship was something you want to follow after that?
Yeah. So as far as how I ended in finance, I'll kind of back up and talk about college too, and kind of how from college, how college transitioned to real world experience. And basically the biggest driver for where I ended up was my dad. So my dad worked in medical devices. He was kind of like one industry person. He worked medical devices his whole career, not on the finance side, but on the manufacturing side. But because of that, and I have a twin brother, by the way, which I don't think I've told you. So I have a twin brother, not identical, but we actually both ended up studying business. That was kind of just, we'll call it in the blood or just the natural interest because of what we saw at home. Mm-hmm. And so I went to the University of San Diego. And at that time, they didn't actually have an entrepreneurial track. Mm-hmm. UT now, which is awesome. And they're starting to get better at that. But at that point, we kind of just learned more traditional business functions, accounting, finance, marketing. I don't know. Those are kind of the big ones. And so I studied finance and marketing as the two areas of concentration. And I actually enjoyed marketing more in college, but ended up doing finance. I don't have a great reason. It wasn't a well thought out plan as far as why to start doing this and then that and then that. We can talk about that, how much you should kind of plan your career out versus how much ends up just unfolding, right. Particularly relevant for those of us that are interested in entrepreneurship. But it just so happened it was 2010, so coming out of the kind of the recession era. Mm-hmm. This firm that I ended up working with called Cabrillo Advisors, they were a small boutique investment banking firm, and they had just at that time, just to give you a little bit of context, the economy was kind of collapsing at that point. And so the ripple effects really impacted M&A. By the way, for those that don't know, M&A is the practice of buying and selling companies. So that we would get hired to either buy a company for someone or to sell a company on behalf of a founder usually. And so that M&A, because of the ripple effects of the economy, had kind of dried up. There wasn't a whole lot happening. And so at about that time, the founders of the firm that I worked at, Cabrillo Advisors, they basically tripped into this practice of valuing businesses, which is a very common thing that investment banks and M&A shops have to do, which is in order to sell or buy a company, you have to put a price on it like a stock. Mm-hmm. Well, public companies in the public markets, you have the stock price that kind of indicates what it's worth and people can put a premium on it, but the baseline is established by the stock price. Private companies, we don't have that. So it's essentially a marketplace where bidders and sellers kind of figure out what the right price point, but you can hire a firm like us to do complete the deal. And part of that is to value the asset itself, the company. Mm-hmm. And so as a result of having that insight and that knowledge already embedded into the investment banking M&A practice, clients started saying, hey, can you do, it's called a 409A, which is valuing the stock options for employees. And the founders of my firm said, sure. And then that practice ended up taking off. And so I got hired around the time where they were doing both M&A, but more so these business valuations.
I know you kind of touched on how you really didn't know why you decided between finance and marketing, but like when you were going through your recruiting process, for some of our viewers who don't know, like the finance and business recruiting process is pretty strenuous and exhaustive almost. So when you were going through that, did you just key in on this company because you liked them a lot and you wanted to stick with finance, or was there?
It's a good question. Yeah. Ultimately, what it came down to was, of the offers that I got, which ones interested me more, what the company itself did. Mm-hmm. That was basically the biggest driver. And actually, to go back to what I was saying before, I always assumed that I was going to end up working at a medical device company, kind of like following the footsteps of my dad. And San Diego was where I went to school. Uh-huh. Is a hotbed for biotech and med device. And just so happened that I got no bites from the medical device community. And so this job just came along and I was interested. I didn't know a whole lot about business valuations, but I knew enough from studying finance about how important it was to kind of do valuations. But we had only really talked about public market valuations. We hadn't really talked about, you know, we did discounted cash flows, mm-hmm. you know, for finance class, but nothing that seemed like, oh, I'm going to be doing this professionally at some point. Mm-hmm. So I was interested in banking, what it all meant. It sounded exciting. And that's what, that started there. And then to kind of continue the story, by being involved with those companies, that is what triggered the interest in entrepreneurship.
Gotcha.
So by working directly with these companies, and we got to meet them, or I met them at an interesting point of their company lives, because when you've reached the point of either doing a business valuation, that basically implies you've just gotten fundraising, which is a great, exciting milestone for a company, or of course the end goal, which is, oh, you've reached the exit. So it's kind of an interesting scenario for me to really start learning about startups and what it means to take a company from start to finish. Mm-hmm. At the end, for the most part. But as I mentioned, we hadn't really been exposed to entrepreneurship in college. Mm-hmm. I was exposed to product development as part of marketing, but not company formation, you know, as far as entrepreneurship. And so where I got my 10,000 hours or my deep dive was by being at, you know, an arm's length on the broker dealer side of these right. deals. And what I realized over time was I'm much more interested, you know, my personality is much more interested in the entrepreneurial side of the business world mm-hmm. than in this, which is, you know, having your head down in Cap IQ or in financial models,
right.
Et cetera. And by the way, do you want me to talk a little bit about investment banking and
that was kind of segued into what my next question was going to be, is like, what were your daily functions essentially, and what did it look like on a day-to-day basis for you when you're working for this finance firm?
Yeah, so
there's a little bit of a difference between working for a boutique versus one where you have maybe thousands of employees. But
that's an important thing for people to note, is that the firm where I worked at it's a boutique firm. What that implies is that it's small. Right. It's small in terms of the number of employees. So we were less than 20 the whole time I was there. Mm-hmm. It's small in terms of the deal size. So the deal sizes were small. It wasn't something that you would read about in Business Insider or the New York, not even close. You know, there was local San Diego business journals would cover some of the deals, but nothing major. And then, and that has an impact into the day-to-day, because when most people start, and particularly if the people listening to this are at college, you will start where I started, which is as an analyst. Mm-hmm. What's cool about working at a boutique firm like mine is that your responsibilities ramp up a lot faster than they would at a big firm because of just scarce resources. And so I went from being an analyst to a senior associate probably fairly quickly compared to somebody who goes to work for a Goldman Sachs or one of the big, right. big investment banks. But as far as the day-to-day, it's very interesting. It's a lot of work, mm-hmm. But you do get to learn a lot about business, and how you get to learn about business is through the numbers. Sorry, did you put your hand up for a question?
Oh, no, you're good.
Okay. Yeah, so what's great about, I'll kind of split it up between investment banking and then business valuation, which were two distinct functions and two distinct project types that we would work on, but I'll start with the M&A. What's really cool and interesting about working on deals as an analyst and eventually, you know, moving up to associate, is you get to really learn about business strategy. So the interesting thing about M&A is sometimes people come to a broker dealer like ours with a list of, hey, here are the, I've already done some of the groundwork. Here are companies that I, as a founder or as a CFO, here are the companies that I want to sell this company to because we've already had some discussions or because I have some strategic insight, some insight based off what I do day to day. Other times it's, I don't know, who do you think could buy me? Right. And so then we would have to go in and start digging around and trying to figure out, okay, where, understanding what the product is, what the team brings, what the customer base, whatever might be interesting to an acquirer. And we have to basically figure out, okay, who would this be interesting to? And so as an analyst, what you would do and what you spend a lot of your days doing is you spend a lot of your days in investment databases, primarily CapIQ. That's what we use. A lot of banks also use Bloomberg, but probably one of those two. And what you're doing a lot of the times is you are running screens. And so that is basically filtering, really digging into a specific set of characteristics for a company. That could be financial, could be geography, could be industry, could be metrics around performance. It varies. But right. Basically, we go to these very expensive databases, and then you start and say, okay, give me a list of as many companies that meet these criteria as possible. That's kind of the starting point. And then we, the analysts, would have to go in and actually dig in deeper and deeper into the companies, just doing research, market research like you would for any sort of due diligence, and come back to our the superior, which was usually in our firm, the partner, because eventually I made my way up to associate. And so usually how it works is you have the analyst, the associate, and then the partner are kind of the three groups of people that work on the deal. The analyst kind of does the grunt work. The associate becomes the liaison between the analyst and the partner. And then the partner does most of the actual client-facing stuff. And, right. And client-facing could mean literally in front of the client or in front of the potential buyer or acquirer, kind of negotiating the deal. That's usually how it's structured. But the analyst does a lot of the grunt work, but it's how you really learn how the whole thing works.
Mm-hmm. And so... And whenever you were actually making the decision that, okay, you know, I've enjoyed doing finance, but it's time for me to transition into entrepreneurship, what did it look like at the time trying to make that decision? Where, you know, what kind of ideas did you have? Where did you think it was going to take you?
So this was, I would say career-wise, this was the most critical, nerve-wracking moment is when I kind of made that turn. Mm-hmm. And when I made the turn was... I ended up taking, oh, and I should say that, remember that the time, so 2007, 2008, there was an explosion of startup activity. That is when Facebook came online. A lot of the companies that are now household names were beginning around that time.
Right.
And so a lot of the big names were consumer technology companies. And so I was familiar with their products, and that's what really got me interested. I was like, oh, that's kind of interesting. I didn't realize that this was, you know, people my age that were making this, putting these products and these companies together. So that kind of clicked an interest. And then the real breakthrough happened when, because of that interest, because my interest was piqued, I saw an ad. I don't even remember where I saw it, but it basically said Google and Techstars, which we'll talk about Techstars later, but Google and Techstars were putting on a program called Next. And basically what this program was, it's actually pretty similar to the course that you're taking with Longhorn Startup.
Yes.
But basically it was a customer discovery lean startup course. And so for 8 weeks, you would go and you could come with an idea or you could formulate a business idea. And then they taught you the frameworks, the process for validating those concepts, and then how to take them to market and scale. Call it a very condensed intro to entrepreneurship and tech entrepreneurship.
Right.
And so I did that course. And after that, I basically knew like, oh crap, like there's no going back. Now everything that I'm doing,
This is what you're hooked on.
My eyes were open after I saw that. Because it taught a repeatable process and a framework for validating ideas. Because a lot of the time, you know, you never really know, is this an idea worth pursuing or not? You could have a strong hypothesis and gut feel about it, but I didn't know of a process for testing that.
Right.
So for anyone watching, by the way, if you're not familiar with Lean Startup, I highly recommend that you read that book. It's basically become canon required reading for any young entrepreneur. And even if you're not particularly interested in entrepreneurship, it's still worth a read because it's a good way to think about how to spot opportunities and just creates a framework for how to not take a crazy guess. Like, you're still taking a guess, but you're basically making it more educated and trying to de-risk those initial business concepts. And so that's what that course was. And after I did that, I said, oh, you know what? I know that this is the track that I want to go down. And so then it became, well, do I want to leave? Do I want to quit my job?
Right.
Do I want to figure out some sort of hybrid? You know, you could launch a company weekend, weeknights, and find a co-founder and kind of validate your initial ideas until a certain inflection point and then go pursue it. So I wasn't entirely sure how I was going to do it, but I knew, like, you know, my life of just doing finance and that seemed like it was coming to an end.
Right.
And what ended up happening around the same time was my parents had moved. So we lived in Orange County, California. My parents moved to Austin, Texas, because my dad moved here for a job with a medical device company. And he said, hey, you should come visit, just because I hadn't seen him in a while. And so I came to visit. And when I came here, my dad said, you know, I know that you've already kind of mentioned that you would be interested in business school. You should check out, oh, sorry, I got a message here. Okay. You should go check out McCombs, because the CEO of my dad's company was a McCombs grad who would rant and rave about how awesome McCombs was. So anyways, I came to Austin, Texas. Exactly, yeah. A man of fine taste. I came to Austin, Texas, visited, checked out McCombs, and I said, oh, this is perfect. And by the way, for those of you who aren't Austin-based, that week just happened to be Austin Startup Week. And so I went to the Startup Crawl, which is a really big, fun event that they do in downtown Austin, where they open up all the doors for all the startups, particularly around Capital Factory, which is a big co-working and accelerator, a co-working spot and accelerator. And so all the companies kind of open their doors and people are walking around looking at products. They have happy hours with happy beers and stuff.
Hundreds of thousands of people.
Lots and lots of people come.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so that was really fun. And also just kind of showed me how Austin, just compared to San Diego, was a much more, it seemed to me a much better fit from an ecosystem perspective for what I wanted to do. So if you wanted to start a biotech company, medical device company, San Diego, perfect. If you're looking more consumer tech, B2B software, that kind of stuff, Austin.
Right.
And so another fun fact, that weekend that I spent with my parents ended with us going to see Paul McCartney at UT. Oh. And I was like, what is this? Like, what is this place?
Everything wrapped up in one for you.
Exactly. And so at that point I said, okay, well, Austin's definitely the next move for me. And so what came down as the big nerve-wracking, you know, we'll say life-changing to sound dramatic, but it's kind of life-changing moment, is I just went and asked at work. I was an associate. I didn't really have, you know, I wasn't a partner. I didn't have a whole lot of sway. I'd been there for a while and people liked the firm and stuff, but I just went and asked my boss, and I said, would it be okay if I moved to Austin, Texas and did everything that I do here, but do it there? And nobody else worked remote. And so basically, since I had already made that decision of like, I want to do this, it was kind of like, well, I might as well just ask, because if they say no, then I know my answer. And I quit this firm and go do something else in Austin. But he said, you know what? No one's ever asked this before. Let me think about how I can best use you if we were to have you move remote. And ultimately they said yes. And then they added like business development responsibilities for me in Austin as well. So I was working remote, getting ready for grad school. And then I wanted to move here and also get involved with entrepreneurship. And so that was about the time when I met who would eventually become my co-founder for Music Meets Video, because we said, hey, we have a shared interest in music and technology. We were both new to Austin. He moved from LA, I moved from San Diego. So there was a bit of a Southern California connection as well. And so, we met, he already had the concept. And so the concept was to do American Idol, but for the YouTube generation. So it would be contests, cover contests or original song contests for YouTubers who are trying to make a name for themselves and need a better platform, because a lot of high quality videos would just get buried on page 36 of YouTube. Mm-hmm. And so the idea was to give those people a platform, a spotlight, so that they could show off their talents. Because there was a lot of really talented, for the most part, kids,
right,
that were just hanging around on YouTube, not really sure what to do. And so we offered cash prizes. So they were decent, you know, for a kid, it was $5,000 for winning the cover contest. It was split up. So it wasn't like one person took 5,000. It was, I think, 3,000 won one or something like that. Mm-hmm. But in any case, that was the concept. And I said, you know what, this makes perfect sense to me. I could see this working. I could see kind of the trend lines with YouTube and gamification and that kind of stuff. So we started Lean Startup, talking to people, interviewing. And after a while, we said, let's pursue it. And so at that point, I was doing finance, Cabrillo Advisors, during the day, and then weeknights, trying to launch, you know, doing the R&D, the initial market research and that kind of stuff for Music Meets Video. Around this time, I saw I got an email. So there's an email that goes around in Austin from Josh Baer. I don't know if he actually writes it or not, but it's from Josh Baer.
From his account.
Yeah, probably not. But it has a whole bunch of tech events, things that just to keep people in the know of what's going on in Austin. And there was a link that said TechStars is looking for help in their Austin program. Mm-hmm. I genuinely thought what they were looking for was like volunteers to like let people into the events and stuff. Oh, and I was familiar with TechStars from working in investment banking and valuations. They just came up on our radar screen. Some of the companies, I think, maybe had been leads at a certain point for valuation. I don't remember, but somehow I knew about TechStars. Mm-hmm. I knew they had a really good reputation, and I knew that their programs were designed to kind of help interesting companies progress.
Right.
And so I clicked on the link, didn't know, had no idea what it was that vague. It just said, looking for help. Mm-hmm. And so I said, okay, well, let me check out what this is. Perhaps there's a way, because I was doing kind of business development stuff as well. Maybe there's a way that we can plug in our firm to the TechStars ecosystem in town.
Yeah,
I was just trying to more or less get more involved with the tech ecosystem here, because I at that point I hadn't, you know, I just moved here. And so long story short, I found out that it was not a request for like volunteers. They were looking for full-time staff members, and particularly what they were looking for were people who had a background in finance, mm-hmm, that could also be helpful to start. And just so you guys know, and so I ultimately got the job, and then mm-hmm, they told me why they gave me the job, and they said, oh, we get a lot of applications for people, but very few of them have kind of like that investment banking background. Mm-hmm. And the few that do are either very, very kind of like traditional finance people. Said another way, they're kind of dull and boring. And so part of being in TechStars is they want somebody who could act, you know, the founders will be interested in working with. So they look for people who kind of have both, who can speak to founders,
right,
in a friendly way, in a normal way, and have that.
The interpersonal finance skills.
So that's why they hired me, because they're like, you're a finance person that isn't like kind of awkward or cold or weird. No offense to the finance people watching.
Oh, yeah. No offense.
But I would say that was the first kind of life-changing thing for me was just getting the guts to ask work, like, hey, will you let me go and do this? And then the second one was doing this TechStars program. So for those of you who do not know, working with TechStars, you basically, if you're staff like I was, you get hired for one program. And what that means is you basically get hired for, I think it's 3 or 4 months. I don't know the exact number. And after that program is done, they will do everything in their power to help you with whatever you want to do next. But it's not like you join TechStars for life. I mean, some people do, but as far as the associates, which is what I was working on, or what I was hired to do, it's essentially, it's a 4-month gig.
Gotcha.
And so, but the idea there is you get so much exposure to the local technology ecosystem, to startup companies, that it will help catapult you to whatever you want to do next with your life. Mm-hmm. And so that was an amazing experience. I call it my pre-MBA MBA, because basically what I did for those 4 months was get in the weeds with startup companies and help them get to whatever their next inflection point was. And it varied because it's 11 companies from all over the world, and they come from all in all shapes and sizes. So there was a couple companies that were not pre-product, like they had a product, definitely we had everything from pre-revenue that were just out of that product market fit phase, mm-hmm. to companies that had been around for a while and were looking for their Series A fundraising. So there's a really big, you know, chasm between the companies. So, you know, us, the lowly associates, they don't give you a playbook or a guidebook. They're like, we don't know what they're going to ask you. You just got to figure it out. And so that was an amazing experience, really rewarding. Made some friends for life, learned a lot about business, but also how to be a leader, how to take something from an itty bitty idea through to getting on a demo day stage in front of all these high net worth people and everything in between. So for those people that are kind of interested in a exposure into startup life from the ground floor, I would highly recommend exploring becoming a Techstars associate. By the way, there's different functions that they look for with associates. So I was helping on the business front. So they asked me for help with getting ready for fundraising, helping them find investors, creating the business plan or investor materials, business strategies. That kind of just fit with my background. Right. But they also look for people that know how to do design, product development. So any main function in business that you can think of, there's probably some need. Mm-hmm. And so they're looking for a variety of people. It's very competitive. Everything with SAR is competitive and difficult to get. But if you're interested, particularly for those of you that are coming out of college, depending on the program, if it's a summer program, then you're in luck because you could actually do it even in college. It could just be your summer, call it internship, right. Which is what we had, because Austin used to be a summer program, but they changed it. And now it would be during the school year, so it wouldn't really work for current students. But if you're looking for something to do maybe after college as a transition or to just keep learning before you figure out what you want to do, that's a great plan. Now, remember that it is a four-month gig. It doesn't pay super well. So, and, you know, it's enough so that you will be able to afford your rent and to have fun. But you won't have savings, you know. It's
just enough for if you're a 20, something year old or whatever.
You can exactly.
Get experience and such.
So that's exactly.
From there, you know, what is it like actually starting your own company and having to make those critical business decisions on the ground level of